Well, good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to have you here in Riggs Library, a place that represents the deepest mission of our institution and the communal aspect of our lifelong commitment to one another, of coming together across disciplines, just as we do today. And I wish to thank all of you who have joined us from other universities and from communities across the globe for this conference. It's a privilege to gather with you this morning to hear remarks from our distinguished guest, Professor Michael Sandel. I look forward to saying a few words about Professor Sandel in just a few moments, but first I wish to express my appreciation to all those who helped to enable us to come together today to provide this context for us to explore how we may foster a culture and an economy that promote human dignity and flourishing. Our gathering has been made possible through the extraordinary support of our partner in this effort, the Pontifical Council for Culture. Since its founding more than three decades ago, the Pontifical Council for Culture has been rooted in the Second Vatican Council's recognition of the unifying force of culture. This is the second event in which we have collaborated with the Council. The first, our Courtyard of the Gentiles Symposium, held in 2014, was the first such gathering to be held in the United States and was convened around the topic a faith, culture, and the common good. We're deeply grateful for this partnership, and I'd especially like to express our appreciation to Bishop Paul Tai, the Secretary of the Pontifical Council for Culture, who joins us here today. Your Excellency, thank you for your support of this very important conversation. I also wish to extend my gratitude to Dr. John Borelli and Dr. Tom Banchoff, our colleagues at the Berkley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, for all that they did to help make this gathering possible. As we come together today, just over 4 years since the historic election of Pope Francis, it's remarkable to reflect on the extraordinary impact of his leadership as he has engaged some of the most pressing challenges of our time, from migration to climate change, to war, to interreligious strife and inequality. On our campus hosted by our initiative on Catholic social thought and public life, 4 years ago, Cardinal Theodore McCarrick described the depth of Pope Francis's commitment to the issue of inequality when he said, quote, "From the moment of his election and his choice of the name Francis and what he says and what he does, our Holy Father is placing solidarity with the poor and vulnerable at the heart of his leadership," close quote. Over the past 4 years, Pope Francis has returned to this central challenge of inequality again and again in his apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, in his encyclical Laudato Si, in his messages and speeches to communities around the world. Last May, when receiving the prestigious Charlemagne Prize in recognition of his work to promote European unity and cooperation between states, Pope Francis shared some reflections on the implications of our current market economy. Quote, "The just distribution of the fruits of the earth and human labor is not mere philanthropy. It is a moral obligation. If we want to rethink our society, we need to create dignified and well-paying jobs, especially for our young people." And he goes on, "To do so requires coming up with new, more inclusive, and equitable economic models aimed not at serving the few, but at benefiting ordinary people and society as a whole," close quote. This challenge to respond to Pope Francis's repeated calls for a culture of encounter, of inclusion, to come up with new, more inclusive and equitable models aimed at benefiting society as a whole is the shared interest that brings us together today. Your work across sectors and disciplines animates and deepens this commitment to human flourishing, to human dignity, and we can see its impact in the diverse efforts across the globe to promote the conditions that enable each of us to fulfill our promise and potential. In the context of this shared commitment, this shared vision, I wish to once again express our sincere appreciation to all of you for your contributions to this critical work and to your presence here today. And now I wish to share a few words about our keynote speaker this morning, Professor Michael Sandel. Professor Sandel currently serves as the Ann T. and Robert M. Bass Professor of Government at Harvard University. He is a distinguished scholar, author, and lecturer. His writings have been translated into 27 languages and are shared around the world. A strong advocate of global public discourse, he has utilized new technology to engage worldwide audiences to grapple with the great ethical questions of our time. His immensely popular lectures have been described as a quote, a kind of Socratic dialogue with his audiences. And his online course entitled Justice has been viewed by tens of millions of people around the world. He is also the best-selling author in his most recent book, What Money Can't Buy, The Moral Limits of Markets, is especially pertinent for our discussion today. In this book, he discusses the idea, quote, the great missing debate in contemporary politics is about the role and reach of markets. Do we want a market economy or a market society? What role should markets play in public life and personal relations? How can we decide which goods should be bought and sold and which should be governed by non-market values? Where should money's writ not run? Close quote. We could not have a conference focused on the questions that we are focused on today without the presence of Professor Michael Sandel. And we are deeply grateful for his presence here today, and we look forward to his reflections and the conversation that will follow, in which he will be joined after his remarks by distinguished author and editor Paul Eli, senior fellow with our Berkley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, the director of the American Pilgrimage Project here at Georgetown. But ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor and privilege for me to introduce to all of you Professor Michael Sandel.
Thank you, President DeGioia, for those generous words of welcome. It's a great privilege to be here. I don't have the opportunity to engage in this kind of discussion every day, so I consider it a real privilege. I would like to connect two tendencies in contemporary life. One of them is the rampant marketization of social life. The other is the hollowness, the moral and spiritual emptiness of public discourse. I'd like to suggest that these two tendencies are not unrelated. And to do so, I'd like to begin by posing a question. What should be the role of markets and money in a good society? The answer, considerably less than today. In recent decades, we've drifted from having market economies to becoming market societies. The difference is this: a market economy is a tool, a valuable and effective tool for organizing productive activity. But a market society is a place where almost everything is up for sale. It's a way of life in which market thinking and market values increasingly reach in to most every sphere of life, from family life and personal relations, to health, education, law, politics, civic life. Should we worry about this? And if so, why? I think there are two reasons to worry, two different reasons to worry about becoming market societies. One reason has to do with fairness and consent. The other has to do with the corruption or degradation of goods and social practices. Of the two reasons to worry about the tendency of market thinking and market values to reach into every aspect of life, of the two reasons, the first, the one about fairness, is the more familiar. But I'd like to suggest that the second, about the corruption of goods, is the more fundamental and far-reaching. And this is because the second objection, the one about the corruption or degradation of goods, touches on intrinsic goods, on conceptions of the sacred. Let me illustrate how these two objections to markets in various settings differ. Take the debate about whether there should be a free market in kidneys for transplantation, human organs for those who desperately need them. Some people favor, in the name of efficiency and increasing the supply of organs, such a market. Others object, typically on one of two grounds. One objection would be that if we had a market for kidneys, let's say, who would be selling them? Most likely people who are desperately poor, but that calls into question how voluntary the transaction, the decision to sell, really is. Or we might object, it would be unfair if those who desperately need kidneys but are poor are priced out of the market, only the affluent can afford them. These objections are of the first kind, the argument from fairness and consent. But there's a second reason one might object to a market in human organs, having to do with, well, intrinsic goods, the idea that allowing such a market would be degrading, at odds with human dignity, that it would promote and express an objectifying view of the human person as a collection of spare parts. This is an instance of the argument from corruption or degradation. Or consider another example. Some years ago, a well-known figure, law professor, federal judge, Richard Posner, one of the founders of the law and economics movement, argued that we should consider allowing a free market in babies up for adoption. It would be a more efficient way of allocating children. Now, you might object to such a market on one of two grounds. You might object that putting children up for sale would be unfair because it would price less affluent parents out of the market, or leave them with the cheapest, least desirable children according to the market valuation. That would be the fairness argument. Or you might object that putting a price tag on children would corrupt the norm of unconditional parental love. It would value children in the wrong way. And the inevitable price differences would reinforce the notion that the value of a child depends on his or her qualities: race, sex, intellectual promise, physical abilities or disabilities, and other traits. This second line of objection is an illustration of the argument from corruption or degradation. It's worth taking a moment to notice the difference between these two arguments. The fairness objection points to injustice that can arise when people buy and sell things under conditions of inequality or dire economic necessity. But the corruption argument points to the degrading effect of market valuation and exchange on certain goods and practices. According to this objection, to buy and sell certain goods is to value them in the wrong way. And this argument, the second argument, can't be met by establishing fair bargaining conditions or by leveling the playing field, which is true of the first argument. Each objection draws on a different moral ideal. The fairness argument draws on the ideal of consent, or consent against fair background conditions. The corruption argument appeals not to consent, but to the moral importance, or to the intrinsic good, or to the sacred character of the things being exchanged. So to decide on the second objection, to decide whether to establish a market in babies up for adoption or a market in human body parts, we have to ask not only about whether it would be unfair to those who can't afford them or to those who would be under pressure in deciding whether to sell, we also have to reflect and to reason about the character of the goods that are at stake in the case of the human body, in the case of kidneys, or in our regard for children in the case of the proposed baby market. Now, I mentioned that the second argument, the more fundamental in my view, is less familiar. Why is that? It's less familiar, I think, because the first, the argument about fairness and consent, fits more comfortably into the public philosophy that informs contemporary life. It fits more comfortably into a public philosophy of a certain version of liberalism. Central to this idea of to this conception of liberalism is the idea that we should not bring into democratic public discourse controversial conceptions of the good life or of virtue or of the sacred. And the reason we should keep such conceptions out of public discourse, according to the liberal conception I'm describing, is that in pluralist societies, we disagree about conceptions of the sacred. We disagree about moral and spiritual questions. We disagree about how to value this or that good. And so to bring such conceptions into public discourse and into democratic decision-making and lawmaking is to run the risk of controversy, but more than that, to run the risk of imposing on some the values of the majority. And so here, I think, lies the connection between, on the one hand, the commodification of social life that's unfolded over the last 3 to 4 decades, and something we've seen unfolding at the same time, the hollowing out of democratic public discourse in this country and in many democracies around the world. I think there's a connection between the two for the following reason. Part of what installs and entrenches the grip of market thinking and market reasoning is not just that we believe markets deliver the goods, that they produce rising affluence and prosperity and GDP. There is a deeper appeal. The deeper appeal is that market reasoning seems to offer a way to decide contested public questions without recourse to controversial conceptions of the good. That, I think, so it's the connection between the reigning liberal public philosophy, whereby liberal I mean it in this special sense, keeping substantive conceptions of the good outside of public discourse. There's a connection between that liberal public philosophy, on the one hand, the emptiness of our public discourse with regard to moral and spiritual questions, and the market triumphalist faith. Now, I'd like to illustrate this with an example. And the example has to do with our regard for and treatment of the environment or the natural world. Now, let's begin with a very small example. I want to talk about global warming. But before turning to global warming, I want to take a more mundane example. Littering, just plain littering. There must be laws, I assume there are laws, against littering in the Grand Canyon. And there is a fine associated, let's assume. I'm not sure this is the case, but I assume there's a fine if you toss a beer can into the Grand Canyon. Now, why is there such a fine, and how should we regard that act? Suppose we're tempted to do so. Well, one way of interpreting it would be to say that doing so makes other people worse off because it blights the view. And it imposes cleanup costs. It's probably quite daunting cleanup costs to go and retrieve the beer can. Suppose the fine is $200, And suppose a wealthy hiker decides it's worth the convenience of not having to carry his beer can with him, and so he tosses it into the Grand Canyon, perfectly willing to abide by the law and pay the $200. And let's suppose that he immediately pays the $200 to the relevant authorities, and they in turn hire a person to go clean up the Grand Canyon from fetching the beer can. Now, would we say, how would we evaluate that act? Has he done anything wrong? Well, from a purely economic point of view, he hasn't. He's imposed some costs, the external effects of his action. He's paid the full cost of it. Let's say the $200 really does cover what it costs to hire the person to go and quickly fetch the beer can. So what has he done wrong? He's followed the law. He's paid the cost. It should be morally a wash. But most of us would probably think there's still something wrong here. Well, what is it exactly? It seems to be that he's misunderstood the distinction between a fee and a fine. A fee is a monetary payment for something, covering costs, whereas a fine registers moral disapproval. In this case, the fine is an expression of the community's determination that littering is a bad act. It reflects bad character, a wanton disregard for the grandeur of the Grand Canyon, its majesty. Maybe it reflects our sense that awe and wonder are the more appropriate responses to the Grand Canyon, not regarding it as an expensive dumpster. So, and I have quickly to add, I encountered another example of this when I was traveling a year ago in Uganda. My son is a graduate student, and he studies chimpanzees in the wild. And he was living for a year in Uganda in the forest studying the chimps. And I visited him there, and we went while I was there to a natural wildlife park in Uganda. And we were being driven through by a local driver with a four-wheel vehicle and looking to try to catch a glimpse of lions and the really interesting things. And it's not always so easy. And we came past a sign, we were driving on this dirt road, saying, off-road driving prohibited, fine, $250. And the driver of the vehicle looked at that sign and he said, oh, what that means is that it's not prohibited to drive off the road. It only costs, it's just that it costs $250. Well, he too had misunderstood this distinction, but he's not the only one. Because here I'd like to turn to a broader question of policy, and that is tradable carbon emission credits. Now, you may remember that 2 decades ago at the Kyoto Conference on Global Warming, there was a debate about this. The US and other developed countries were prepared to accept mandatory targets for carbon emissions, but only on the condition that they be accompanied in the agreement by tradable market in emissions, in carbon emissions, which would have meant that the US, for example, could fulfill its obligations either by reducing its own greenhouse gas emissions to its assigned target or by paying to reduce emissions someplace else. So rather than, say, tax gas-guzzling Hummers in the US, we could pay to restore an Amazonian rainforest or to modernize a coal-burning factory in a developing country. And the argument is that this is a more efficient way for the same amount of money to achieve greater reduction or to achieve the necessary reductions at less cost. Now, at the time, this is 1997, I got into trouble. I wrote an op-ed in the New York Times arguing against this trading scheme. I worried that letting countries buy the right to pollute would be like letting this guy in the Grand Canyon pay to toss his beer can. I thought we should try to strengthen, not weaken, the moral stigma attached to despoiling the environment. And I worried that if rich countries could buy their way out of the obligation to reduce their own emissions, we would undermine the sense of shared sacrifice necessary to future global cooperation on climate change. Well, this op-ed appeared, and a few days later, the Times was flooded with scathing letters, mostly from economists, many of them my Harvard colleagues. They said, I fail to understand the virtues of markets, or the efficiencies of trade, or even elementary principles of economic rationality. Amid this torrent of criticism, I did receive a sympathetic email from my old, the economics professor I had in college. He wrote that he understood the point I was trying to make, but he also asked a small favor. Would I mind not publicly revealing the identity of the person who had taught me economics? Well, so that was 20 years ago, and I felt pretty much in the wilderness on this question, at least. But then, just recently, I read the encyclical of Pope Francis on climate change, and I found that I wasn't alone in the wilderness. Now, the language of the encyclical is suggestive and telling for the distinction with which I began between the argument from fairness and the argument from the corruption or degradation of intrinsic goods and attitudes. Because the argument of the encyclical, and it's a closely reasoned moral argument, is that it's not enough to come up with technological fixes for global warming and climate change. Instead, this is an occasion to reconsider the mode of life and the values and attitudes and the stance of human beings toward the natural world that have given rise to the environmental crisis. He writes, Pope Francis does, that if we approach nature and the environment without an openness to awe and wonder, if we no longer speak the language of fraternity and beauty in our relationship with the world, our attitude will become that of masters, consumers, exploiters, unable to set limits on their immediate needs. And he cited the teaching of St. Francis, which he said was no mere asceticism, but something more radical, a refusal to turn reality into an object simply to be used and controlled. So these are the larger stakes. It's not only about coming up with a public policy to deal with climate change, it's about transforming ourselves. Once we lose our humility and become enthralled with the possibility of limitless mastery over everything, we inevitably end up harming society and the environment, he wrote. And so environmental education, he said, has to be about more than policies and facts. It must, quote, promote a new way of thinking about human beings, life, society, and our relationship with nature. And he added, we need to reject a magical conception of the market. Because where profits alone count, there can be no thinking about the rhythms of nature, its phases of decay and regeneration. Biodiversity is considered, from the purely economic or technocratic point of view, at most a deposit of economic resources available for exploitation, with no serious thought for the real value of things. So back to intrinsic goods or sacred goods. And then he takes on directly the buying and selling of carbon credits. This system, he writes, seems to provide a quick and easy solution under the guise of a certain commitment to the environment. But in no way does it allow for the radical change which present circumstances require. It may simply become a ploy which permits maintaining the excessive consumption of some countries. Now, shortly after the encyclical appeared, there appeared in the New York Times letters to the editor and op-ed pieces saying, wonderful that Pope Francis is in favor of dealing with global warming, but isn't it too bad that he added all of this moral language and came out against carbon trading? So his encyclical elicited the same outrage from economists and certain policy wonks that mine had. In fact, there was one article in the New York Times included a quote from the director of environmental economics at the Harvard Kennedy School, whose quote is as follows. I respect what the Pope says about the need for action, but this, referring to his critique of carbon trading, is out of step with the thinking and work of informed policy analysts around the world who recognize that we can do more, faster, and better with the use of market-based policy instruments. And the guy who wrote this was one of the people who wrote a letter that appeared back 20 years ago against me. But the more revealing op-ed, and I kept track of the negative press that Pope Francis was collecting on this issue, the more interesting and revealing op-ed a few days after the encyclical came not from an economist but from a philosopher who attacked the encyclical's case against carbon trading on very astute grounds. This was from a philosopher in Toronto who wrote as follows. The Pope gets, well, here, I should tell you this. He said, I find nothing objectionable about the Pope's moralizing tone and language of sin. That was generous. But then he says, but the Pope gets carried away condemning the efficiency-driven paradigm of technology, overlooking the fact that efficiency is a moral principle. This commitment can be found, I'm still quoting from the philosopher, at the heart of the polluter pays principle, which Pope Francis also endorses. Now, most people like this idea when it's read forward, if you pollute, then you should pay. They dislike it, however, when read backward. If you're willing to pay, then you should be allowed to pollute. But he's saying that, strictly speaking, these are equivalent. We're back to the guy in the Grand Canyon tossing the can. These are equivalent. It's the second reading that offends people when they contemplate rich countries, you know, paying people in poor countries to reduce their emissions for them, yet any sensible approach must allow this. Now, but what's astute about this reply by this philosopher is that he glimpses the larger stakes. He says the Pope is not hostile to market mechanisms because he's a raving socialist, as some have suggested. Instead, his stance is a natural consequence of his theology. Remember, says the writer, the philosopher, even though the Pope is adopting a progressive stance on the environment, he is not a liberal. The fundamental problem with markets in Pope Francis's view, I'm still quoting, is that they cater to people's desires, whatever those desires happen to be. What makes the market a liberal institution is that it does not judge the relative merits of these desires. And that's what the Pope doesn't like about that. That's what makes the Pope not a liberal. He wants an economic system not that satisfies whatever desires people happen to have, but the desires that they should have. a system that promotes the common good. But the philosopher disagrees with that way of thinking because, he points out, people disagree about what the common good is. And the Pope is appealing to a conception of the common good, he claims, that is specifically Christian. And on that basis, he's criticizing carbon trading. But the philosopher thinks this is a mistake. It's a mistake to reject the liberalism that is non-judgmental with respect to the content of desires. And one reason it's a mistake is that we don't agree on how to value intrinsic or sacred goods. And furthermore, quote, the problem of climate change is so urgent we can't wait around waiting for people to come to some kind of spiritual agreement. All that we can demand is that people pay the full cost of that their consumption imposes on others. The fee and the fine, the beer can, the driver in the Ugandan wildlife preserve. Well, the merit of this critique by the philosopher, which sees more clearly what's at stake than those economists who are saying, well, this is just irrational, is that it brings out the connection between our becoming market societies and our having a kind of public discourse that is empty of larger moral and spiritual meaning. What does this suggest for how we should think about markets? Once we see that markets and commerce change the character of the goods they touch, sometimes by corrupting them, sometimes by valuing them in the wrong way, sometimes by indulging desires that are unworthy, once we see that, then we have to ask where markets belong and where they don't. And we can't answer this question without deliberating about the proper way of valuing goods. We can't answer this question without reflecting publicly, not just privately, about intrinsic goods, even about sacred goods. Now, such deliberations touch unavoidably on competing conceptions of the good life. This is terrain on which we often fear to tread. For fear of disagreement, we hesitate to bring our moral and spiritual convictions into the public square. But shrinking from these questions does not leave them undecided. It simply means that markets will decide them for us. This is the lesson of the last three decades. The era of market triumphalism has coincided with a time when public discourse has been largely empty of moral and spiritual substance. Our only hope of keeping markets in their place is to find our way to a rejuvenated democratic discourse that enables us to deliberate openly and publicly about the meaning of the goods in the social practices we prize. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael. What a privilege to have you here and to have you connect the dots for us in the way that you just did, with everything from the beer can and the Grand Canyon to Pope Francis in his encyclical. It's really extraordinary to hear you speak again. Thank you. When you wrote What Money Can't Buy, there had just been real tumult in the stock market. People were talking for a time about the limits of markets. There was some expression of what you call the fairness argument in Occupy Wall Street, and to a certain extent in some of the language of the Tea Party. That's some years ago now. Has anything changed since you made that argument?
Well, we've had an election. And I think what happened in the election is not unrelated to some of these themes. But before saying why I think that, I can't let the occasion pass. Paul has a copy of What Money Can't Buy here. And Paul was my editor when he was back in his life as an editor at FSG, both for What Money Can't Buy and for Justice. And so both of these books bear his mark and his thoughtfulness and his insights. And I just wanted to thank you, Paul, for that very much.
Thank you.
And now, FSG's loss is Georgetown's gain. But to turn to your question and the election, I think that what we saw in the past election was a backlash against a public discourse empty of larger moral meaning. Now, in the nature of backlashes, it's in their nature that they are blunt and imprecise and often contain a lot of ugliness. But I think we should not allow ourselves, I think we should condemn the ugliness, but not allow it to distract us from the legitimate grievances with which the dark side of Trump and right-wing populism around the world are entangled. And I think that there are fundamental questions about values, about human dignity, about the scope of national community in the face of a globalizing economy, about the tendency of unchecked, market-driven globalization to undermine and dislocate communities, and to deprive especially working people of the basis of self-respect and the dignity of work. I think this concatenation of unaddressed moral questions caught up with the liberal technocratic dispensation that had gone unquestioned and that contributed to a certain kind of smug complacence, I think, among the Democratic Party in the U.S., also the political elites in Britain who did not see Brexit coming. I think something similar was at stake there. So in a way, I think both Brexit and the election of Trump were an angry verdict on 3+ decades of the kind of politics, not only that was morally and spiritually empty, but that had a tin ear for the anger and resentments created by a system of globalization that heaped its rewards on those at the top, but left other people, ordinary people, feeling disempowered and and dislocated.
So the anger out there is an anger of people who are recognizing the limits of a market society and the way it doesn't allow a place for them, and yet the coarseness of the discourse has to do with our lack of a vocabulary, a way to speak about these things?
Yes, it's coarse because people are angry and resentful, and they feel that elites are looking down on them. And they're not entirely wrong about that. One of the biggest divisions now in American politics is between those who've been to college and those who haven't. And I'm struck, I think back in 1958, British sociologist Michael Young wrote a book called The Rise of the Meritocracy. He coined the term meritocracy. And we consider, for the most part, meritocracy to be a term of praise, an ideal worth aspiring to. We don't have perfect equality of opportunity, everyone knows that, but if only we did, then allowing the market to function would reward those who deserved it. That's the idea underlying meritocracy and underlying the agenda of making equality of opportunity fuller, truer, removing barriers. But what Michael Young meant by meritocracy was actually a dystopian vision, not an ideal. Because what he glimpsed was that as rewards in place and position based on class, as those were giving way, that they were giving way to a system where people would rise to the top based on their merit. And he thought there would be, that if that ever came true, really true, it would be deeply oppressive and insulting to those on the bottom who could no longer say, well, I was born, I had the bad judgment to be born to poor parents. They would have to take it as a judgment on themselves. And worse, those on the top would take their success as the measure of their virtue and merit. Now, he thought that in the year 2033, there would be a populist revolt, and he used that word, populist revolt, against this new dispensation. Well, he was just, it came 17 years early. I think that the resentment of elites reflects a legitimate anger at a system that rewards people on the top. Those people inhale deeply of their success, believing they deserve it in virtue of their talents and hard work. And by implication, those on the bottom deserve their fate. And it's interesting, neither Trump nor Bernie Sanders talked that language. From Bill Clinton to Barack Obama to Hillary Clinton, part of what was tinny about Hillary Clinton's public discourse, insofar as she had a theme, it was this: removing barriers so that everyone could rise as far as their talents would take them. But that's puzzling in a way. Why would that be a just society, even if you could achieve it, where people on top would be the ones who had, for whatever reason, greater talents than those at the bottom? Why would that be a basis of moral desert? Neither Trump nor Bernie Sanders talked the language of trying to perfect equality of opportunity. They talked about inequality of power in different ways. So I think part of the, and this is an overly elaborate answer to the question you put to me, Paul, but I think the anger at the markets, the way the market distributed rewards, is deepened by the meritocratic story we tell ourselves. Not only are the winners in a market society and in a market-driven globalization fortunate or lucky, they get what they deserve. And so do you. And people don't like that, rightly so.
So the meritocracy is market-based thinking by another name, in that it obscures the fact that our talents, otherwise known as our gifts, aren't our own doing. We enter life with a variety of gifts that then get reckoned in market terms rather than in human terms.
Exactly. And you're shifting from the language of talents to gifts, and we do use them interchangeably, is very telling. Because the language of gifts invites us to consider that it's not our own doing. Talents, the language of talent seems easier to assimilate to effort, my own doing. So I think the way out of this is exactly as your language suggests, Paul, that we have to find a way to encourage and remind those on top to regard their the talents that got them there as gifts for which they are indebted rather than as their due. And I think that there is an underlying, unarticulated recognition of this. As, for example, when you remember after the financial crisis, the financial industry came in for quite a bit of public criticism, and the head of Goldman Sachs blurted out, I think when he was under pressure at a congressional hearing, "We're doing God's work." when he was asked whether, you know, high-speed trading really did contribute all that much to the common good. We're doing God's work. So I think we need, well, maybe to build on that suggestion, even if to question the way he applied it and the activity to which he applied it. But just to pick up on one other thing you said, Paul, the meritocracy installs the market dispensation, but it goes a step further. It then moralizes the results of what the market has dispensed. And that makes it not only unfair, but also galling. There are two different responses to inequality, if you're looking up. One of them is to say, the system is rigged, it's unfair. And if you say that and believe that, then you work to try to bring about a more fair system. But another response is to say, maybe because the American dream is so interwoven with this meritocratic idea, maybe I haven't worked quite as hard. Maybe I'm not quite as talented. Maybe I haven't contributed quite as much as Bill Gates or Steve Jobs. And so this, and the two coexist and are in tension. And when you get the second, that fuels anger and resentment. It's the difference between regarding the arrangement as unfair and regarding it as humiliating in a way. And I think that the reason that our politics is roiled with the anger and resentment that it is because there's not just unfairness, but also a kind of humiliation that goes with this moralizing the outcome, the dispensations of the market arrangements.
So the market society is claiming to be agnostic about goods,
yes,
but in fact it's moralizing left, right, and center.
Yes.
And meanwhile,
yes,
leaving out all sorts of other goods that aren't equated with success in our society.
Exactly.
The good of raising your children in a certain way,
yes,
or cultivating your garden, or contributing to community life. These things, they don't contribute to success, so we don't value them in the market society.
Exactly. Exactly.
And the people who are left out of the success culture, the vocabulary to value those other things is withering, or is just, yeah, not there anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
When I first met you, you learned that I'd gone to Fordham, and you said, "You know, Paul, you have to understand, I'm a dissident at Harvard, but what I say would be perfectly straightforward and intelligible at Fordham." What did you mean by that?
Is this being recorded? What's going to happen? You'll tell me later, maybe. Well, I would put it this way. It's very difficult to make the case. Well, I would put it another way. It's not difficult to make the case. I chatting with President DeJoy outside just before we began, I said that we're engaged in a countercultural project. Those of us who are concerned with bringing a language of the common good more directly to bear on public life. And that's because, it's partly because of the prestige and presence of a certain economic way of thinking that dominates not only economics as conducted in the academy, mainstream economics. There are dissenting voices. Mainstream economics has a self-confidence about itself as a science of human behavior, a value-neutral science of human behavior and social choice, that has allowed it to break free of its historic entanglement with and subordination to moral and political philosophy. If you think back to the classical economists, from Adam Smith to John Stuart Mill and Karl Marx, despite their ideological differences, they shared the view that economics was a subfield of moral and political philosophy, not a separate value-neutral science. But the way we, for the most part, teach economics these days in universities, that's no longer the case. So that's part of what I was thinking. But more than that, even among philosophers, philosophy, analytic philosophy, Anglo-American analytic philosophy, has absorbed many of these same aspirations and, I would say, prejudices, which is to keep moral and spiritual discourse outside of public discourse about law, what the law should be. And that's why I say that trying to make space for a language of the common good in public democratic discourse is leaning against the current. In most places that I go, though not at Fordham and Georgetown.
We hope not.
You'll tell me. I mean, I don't know. That's what I'm imagining.
So in the book, you track the expansion of market-based thinking in everyday life, but there's a parallel expansion of market-based thinking in intellectual life where economics used to be the dismal science, and now it's the exuberant science that will explain everything to everyone.
Yes.
And take other fields into itself.
Yes, it was better when it was more dismal and less exuberant and less smug in its conviction that it's possible to discuss social and economic arrangements in a way that is detached from moral reflection. So part of my project, I think our biggest, most fundamental project is, those of us who share these concerns, is to recast the terms of public discourse and democratic citizenship to make it more hospitable to moral and spiritual argument. But a related concern that I have is to argue for reconnecting economics, the way it's studied and taught, to reconnect it with moral and political philosophy, to reinvent the old discipline of moral and political economy as a unitary field of study.
And how do you do it? Is it just using these terms and saying them in as many different places as possible? Does it have an effect? Or what should we do if we want to reclaim some of the space for a humanist discourse and the space that's now taken up by market thinking? How do we do it?
Well, I think we have to go case by case and try to show the limits of moral reasoning that tries to proceed in technocratic terms or in moral terms that keep conceptions of the good outside. So the debate about climate change and global warming that I spoke about is one example, but I think we need to have those debates with regard to a whole range of public questions, including healthcare, which has been largely fought out in technocratic terms, to the way we conceive education. So that's at the level of trying to influence public discourse. But I also think we have to try to nurture communities within civil society that already are sites for this richer kind of public discourse. I don't think we can hope through public discussion and debate and op-ed pieces and so on to change national public discourse without at the same time relying on civil society to provide places where citizens can gather and speak in public about such things. Schools, congregations, unions, social movements. These are, I think, indispensable sites for any attempt to rejuvenate public discourse writ large. We have to start in the, Tocqueville wrote when he was so struck by the New England township and its place in democracy, in American democracy, about citizens learning the habits and dispositions that equip them to exercise self-government in the small sphere within their reach. But the idea is that as this sphere becomes larger, the reach can then expand. So I think we have to, that this project has to try to draw strength from these sites within civil society where a more, a richer kind of public discourse already to some extent is present.
When I hear you say that and think about it in the Catholic context, I think about in incentivizing and the role of incentives. Historically, Christianity had a certain incentive-based arrangement that you were going to get into heaven if you behaved in a certain way. That way of thinking about Christianity has receded. We don't think of the heavenly incentive to the extent that we once did. Mm. So our community now tries to look for other ways to explain things. Why should we have a common life? Because it's good for us? Or should we try to explain it in incentive-based terms that it's attractive, or you'll get a better job, or life will be more interesting? I know that this is just a quandary that I faced in my adult life as a Catholic. How do we think about these things? Should we use incentive-based language, or should we just assert there's a common good that has nothing to do with the market, and it's good for you people, so come along with us?
Well, I'm inclined to say, and here I'm speaking as a friendly and sympathetic onlooker, I'm inclined to say the second, that the language of what's good for a person rather than the incentive language, you can't give up on that. I don't think we can give up on that. Speaking more broadly, I think that the incentive moral and spiritual education that leans too heavily on incentives, even the incentive of salvation, is not self-sufficient. It's not enough to inspire. And the danger is that leaning too heavily on incentives, which are often incentives of fear, in the case of theologies, makes a faith tradition vulnerable to the slide into other incentives, like indulgences, which are a classic example of a good that money can't buy, though people tried. And that generated its own backlash, if I remember correctly. But it's a little bit that the question. It's a deep question. It reminds me of a similar question that comes up in another setting, which is to do with the humanities and the place of the humanities in a liberal arts education. And we read all the time about the humanities being in crisis, and fewer students enrolling or majoring in the humanities, instead flocking to computer science or economics. And very often, under this pressure, commissions on the humanities and groups that try to come up with reports on how to revive the humanities, how to make the case for the humanities, come up with reports that talk, that essentially say, here's a famous person who made a lot of money, and do you know what? He or she was a humanities major. That's the incentive. That's the incentive way. And I think it, I don't think it carries conviction ultimately. I don't think it wins over many students to the study of the humanities. And I think it's bad faith, and people know that, students know that. Now, whether that also applies in, well, do you think that that analogy is true? What do you think in the case of Catholic community and theology in relation to incentives, I mean?
Yeah, well, Peter Thiel, the founder of PayPal, studied with René Girard, the Catholic philosopher, and I don't, I'm not sure that one is connected with the other in a good way. I think Pascal, in one of his most enigmatic pensées, said, make religion attractive. And Pope Francis has made religion enormously attractive and has made care for our common home enormously attractive. But I think that that's partly the issue that some of his detractors have with him, that it's considered improper to make this stuff attractive, that it should just be good for you.
Yeah, I wouldn't divorce the two, though. Having a theology and a faith, bringing out its attractive qualities and persuading adherents that it's actually for their good, I don't think those are at odds, if what you mean by it's good for you is not the incentive-based idea, the cruder version that you were describing, that simply mobilizes fear or the desire to make money. I mean, those are the two classic, when one speaks of incentives, those are the two classic motivations that incentives appeal to, fear or making money. Those are the big ones, anyhow. And they can compel obedience, at least for a time up to a point, but they can't inspire. And that's why I think that, but to speak of faith or a faith tradition as being attractive or inspiring, I think it can be in line with people coming to see it's for their good without thinking of it in incentive terms, a stick over their head.
I know there are questions from the audience, but I have one last question of my own. And so you took the position you took on Kyoto in 97, and now, 20 years later, we have an immensely attractive, influential public figure speaking eloquently and powerfully about alternatives to the market society. Does it make a difference in your work? Does someone at that level speaking this language have an effect? And what effect is it?
Well, yes. The voice of Pope Francis has had, I assume you're speaking about Pope Francis and not our new president. the voice of Pope Francis has, I think, had a tremendous impact by offering not only an attractive example, but of showing how it can be done. And by it, I mean engaging in a kind of moral reasoning that draws upon a faith tradition that not everyone shares, but that nonetheless is accessible to those within and outside the faith. And very often, when I've tried to make the case as a matter of moral and political philosophy, that we should be more welcoming of all sources, moral and spiritual, secular, spiritual, and otherwise, all moral sources in public discourse and moral argument. People invariably say, but if someone brings a spiritual or faith tradition to bear in democratic public discourse, that excludes everybody who doesn't share that faith. And I've tried to argue in the abstract, not necessarily, depends how it's done. People have in mind a dogmatic assertion. Often when people think of religion having a place in public discourse, they say, well, but you can't reason with these people, that's what they say, because they're dogmatic. And that's why, to which my answer has always been, dogmatism is damaging to democratic public discourse, but I don't think the faithful have a monopoly on dogma or dogmatic arguments in democratic discourse. So what Pope Francis shows by his example is that it's possible to engage in moral reasoning that is rooted in a faith tradition and a theology that is nonetheless accessible and available and open to argument and disagreement by democratic citizens generally. And that's the power of his example. And as far as how I draw on this, even when I'm out of doors, so to speak, not in the Riggs Library at Georgetown, I've been doing a series trying to use new technology to create global public discussions about ethical questions for the BBC. And we use a new high-tech studio where there's a wall of 60 with 60 monitors, and there can be someone in each from different countries around the world. We have about 30 or 40 countries represented. And one of the top, we did one on immigration, the ethics of immigration and the refugee crisis, and one on meritocracy. And we also did one on global warming. And as the discussion unfolded, I gave them a passage from Pope Francis' encyclical on global warming. And the one that argued about the need to transform attitudes, not just to come up with a scheme or a fix. And I was interested to hear how people would react to that argument. And so I formulated it as a question, because there's a polling device that begins the discussion. And I said, suppose that science were able to come up with a technological fix to climate change that would enable us to address the problem of global warming without changing our attitudes or our values. Would that be an unqualified good, or would it be a mixed blessing, that technology? And that was the question I put to them, and they disagreed. They divided, and we had a debate about that. But even that formulation of the question was made possible for me by the fact that Pope Francis had made that argument, which is a different way of reasoning about this great challenge that we all face.
I can't wait to see that. It's going to be a airing next year, or?
Well, it's online now. I can say, if you go to BBC The Global Philosopher, Sandel or something, and you can put in the climate change one, or there are four of them on there, you can see.
Thank you so much. Are there questions in the audience? Yes.
Thank you. Galen Curry, National Association of Evangelicals. There's a current debate about protecting our safety net and also about foreign aid, and there are a lot of times utilitarian arguments advanced. You know, if we feed children, their brains will develop and then they'll work better.
Right.
If we care for the poor abroad, they won't become terrorists and so on. Do those some people think those arguments have more resonance than saying
right.
It's the right thing to do.
Right.
But do those kind of arguments undermine the sense of culture of the common good that you're advocating?
It's a great question. They do, but that doesn't mean we should never use them. Because sometimes utilitarian arguments can be important strategically to win support for important measures, such as the ones you're describing. And in those cases, and this is a matter of practical judgment that's bound up with moral reasoning, in those cases, we need to decide whether to pay the price in corrupting attitudes for the sake of getting the healthcare program or the aid to the developing world in a given moment. What's important is that when we make those utilitarian arguments, we not lose sight of the fact that those arguments are an expedient that may be morally justified. But that's not easy to do because there's a tendency, especially if they work, to have rather frequent recourse to them and to forget that they are an expedient that may be taking a toll on attitudes that ultimately may be corroded and unavailable to support other larger, morally more ambitious projects. Another example of this, or one form it takes, is talk. You hear this in policy circles all the time, including ones committed to the developing world and to good things, to speak of human capital. It's increasing human capital, this anti-poverty program, let's say, because they'll grow up and they'll become productive workers and they'll pay taxes and so on. The recipients. Well, the language of human capital I always find grating and disquieting because it gets us and it distracts us from the language or displaces the language of the human person. So sometimes we have to make a devil's bargain, but it's important to remember it for what it is.
Question right there.
Hi, thanks for being here. My name is Adam Wagner. I'm a student at Georgetown. My question is kind of twofold. I think they relate. So if we were to replace our kind of current market-based discourse with more discussion on morals, who decides what those morals are and how do we avoid kind of neo-colonialist thinking and like the tyranny of the majority?
Right. That's a great question. Thank you for that. Well, the short answer is who decides? We do. Where we democratic citizens do. And now it's true when you mention the risk of lapsing into neo-colonialist presumption. It's true that the community of those engaged in the public discourse, in the moral reasoning, we have to pay attention to that, because if we don't, we'll fall prey to the danger that you describe. Sometimes when people ask the question, but who's to decide what the common good means, or what is what counts as a sacred good? Who's to decide? Sometimes that's a rhetorical question meant to suggest that there is no right answer to these questions, and therefore we shouldn't engage in them. But I don't think that was the spirit of your question. I think when you were saying who should decide, who's to decide, you actually meant that as a question of who should be the participants and how should we decide. I mean, I think we need quickly to change the question to how should we decide, and which is to say, how should we engage in moral reasoning under conditions of disagreement? Disagreement about morality and disagreements about faith, and to respond to that challenge, how should we decide? We have to look to the various traditions of moral reasoning and of of political philosophy to get some instruction and some suggestion, which is why I think this enterprise must also have a history. I think that our ability to reason together about hard moral questions is enriched if it's informed by an exposure to Plato and Aristotle, and for that matter, Confucius, and those discourses of reflection on the right way to live and to organize our societies that come from different communities.
Question in the far back.
Healthcare certainly is a moral issue that's... Thank you. Healthcare is certainly a moral issue that's immediately at hand. The Affordable Care Act of the Obama administration included as necessary mandates, which are now being challenged by the current administration. The issue of insurance, it seems to me, is one for all and all for one. The mandates were to be incentives, and yet they've not had the effect that we hope for,
right.
And as a consequence,
right.
A cascade of events.
Right.
How would you structure that?
Right. The dilemmas that we've been discussing really are very much at stake, just as you suggest in the debate about healthcare. The mandates were seen by the critics as a violation of freedom. You're being forced to buy a product, an insurance plan, health insurance plan, whether you want to or not. And the sanction, well, it's interesting. You have to pay a penalty if you don't under Obamacare. Is that penalty a fee or a fine? Well, it's too low currently to get everyone to do it. So you might say, oh, well, that's just a technical problem and a political problem. If it were higher, then more people would abide by it, would get the insurance rather than pay the fine. Or is it a fine? Or is it a tax? And this on this question, the Supreme Court decision and Justice Roberts' decision hung. And he saved the constitutionality of it, as you know, by construing it as a tax. But what this suggests is that the whole mandate, I think the mandate was an unfortunate expedient, kind of like we were discussing earlier, that arose because this was a jerry-rigged system. You'll forgive me if you were involved in the planning of the policy. A jerry-rigged system trying to expand access and coverage without fundamentally changing the private insurance market, the provision of health insurance through private insurance companies. I think it would have been better, the way I would change it, would be to have a single-payer healthcare system and be done with it, have Medicare for everyone. And the critics would the argument against that that one often hears is, well, they'll call that socialized medicine. But they called Obamacare socialized medicine, even though it kept these private insurance companies in place and had to go through these rather elaborate contortions, including the mandate, to try to get everybody into the risk pool. It was an ugly approximation of a moral argument that we are all in this together and we should all share one another's fate with regard to the provision of health. So I would back up and say the underlying problem, now I know it's politically difficult, but the underlying problem, it goes back to the language and the attitudes that we want to cultivate. The underlying problem is that there was never really made a robust moral argument that we owe it to our fellow citizens to see to it that access to healthcare should not be based on the ability to pay, but on the need for it. And that's part of what it means to be a citizen. That should have been the moral argument. But what happened, and it's a perfect example, even President Obama, who was very gifted in some areas, lost his moral voice for the most part when it came to arguing for Obamacare, because it was so heavily technocratic and elaborate and jerry-rigged and had made so many concessions to the private health insurance industry and the pharmaceutical companies. And so I heard him in the summer before it was voted on. I'm a kind of a C-SPAN addict. I like to hear kind of long, unfiltered political speeches. And I heard him explaining it, saying, well, we have to bend the cost curve in the out years. Well, I thought, no wonder he's having trouble getting this passed. There's nothing inspiring in that. And then in the fall came, and he, in a speech to Congress, read a letter that Ted Kennedy had written him about health care. That Ted Kennedy had just died, and he read it. And there was the moral argument based on mutual obligation of citizens for one another. There it was. And he read it beautifully. But it was Ted Kennedy's letter. And so I think we shouldn't underestimate the price we pay. It goes back to this issue of lapsing into utilitarian or technocratic language to achieve ends that we ourselves privately, yes, we do have a moral impetus, as I'm sure Obama did have a moral conviction that everyone should be covered and the risk should be shared and the cost should be shared. Of course, he believed that. But he became so captured by the language of technocracy and bending the cost curves in the out year that he, of all people, lost the ability to make a moral argument for it. And I think that's why it continues to be vulnerable. Because though they got it through with the technocratic arrangements and the mandate, and it just squeaked through the Supreme Court and it got through the Congress, there was never, the way was never prepared by a broader moral argument about what we owe one another as citizens.
Wow, I just learned something really important. That was phenomenal. Thank you so much. There'll be opportunity for a few further questions during the break, I think. But thank you all for being here for this first session, and we'll reconvene here in a few minutes. Thank you.